management problem for performing project drones. Obviously, in every country, there is a lot of efforts and a lot of interest in making this or bringing this unmanned transportation, unmanned aerial vehicle transportation to the real world. Everybody heard of projects like, at least ideas like Amazon's delivery, even starting from excellent or killer applications like delivering medical supplies for emergencies scenario, and all the way to simple things like pizza delivery. But all these things, all of them are still, you know, it takes time to bring those big ideas to reality. So the academics like you and me, and also the visionaries like the federal aviations in different countries, we all have to work together to make this happen. Today, the technology is not matured, and also there are not enough regulations for safety and security of people. So even though industry is like Amazon is trying to go forward, but today we need to still bring the technologies to the forefront, and also make sure that we have enough regulations for safety and security before we get things done. So IEEE is a pioneer in many of the standards related activities. For example, today there are vehicle to vehicle communications for automobiles, and that was led by IEEE. And even before IEEE 802.11 is a Wi-Fi standard that we are using today. Almost in every household, everywhere we use IEEE 802.11, and that's also developed by, of course, IEEE. So given that IEEE has the background and the expertise to develop the standards, today we are engaged in developing standards for drone communications. So there are two projects that IEEE is leading. And one is 1920.1. That is for aerial ad hoc networks. 1920.2 is for vehicle-to-vehicle communications for unmanned aircraft systems. So both these are related to communications. And again, I'm serving as chair for these two groups. And in this context, the plan here is to promote research and education activities, especially among the younger generation like all of you. So that is the motivation behind it. I will discuss the background, and of course, when you registered, there are a lot of questions that came up. I tried to summarize these questions in few topics, and then I will discuss one by one. Probably within half an hour, my presentation will be over, or even less than that. I won't take much time to present. Then I'll just discuss the general questions and the answers to them based on what you asked while you registered. Then we can open up for questions from you. So once again, please keep your microphones mute until there is a reason for you to ask a question. The first 20-25 minutes, listen to me, listen to the presentation. I'll give all the background that you need. Also try to answer the general questions, and we will move on to, we'll open the floor for your question. This is I was already introduced, but however, I'll just give you the key points. I'm partnering with NASA on advanced air mobility research, and that project actually is starting now. Just a few days back, the project has started. And again, the goal for advanced air mobility is to engage industry and academics to understand the challenges. There are many challenges that some challenges we know and some we don't even know. So before bringing drones into our communities, practically on top of our heads, we need to understand what kind of problems we are going to foresee. What are the issues, especially safety and security? Then, and how do we address them? Once we know the problems, then we can figure out how to address. So that is That is the situation now from all across, all over the world, especially researchers and professionals who want to see this exciting research or exciting development in the real world. So my background is I wrote a book on unmanned, working on a book now on unmanned air transportation. Then I published a book on UAV communications in 2017, and I'm chairing 1920.1 and 1920.2. And 1920.1 is about to complete. Probably by beginning of next year, standards will be available. And that's about aerial ad hoc networks. 1920.2 is very specifically vehicle-to-vehicle communication. So that is very focused. And the work is going on now. We just started. We hope to have something by in 1 year. There is a for those who are working in research and development, there is a special issue coming up in June that will have several papers on communication support for unmanned air transportation. So I have some practical experience. And most important thing that I really am proud of is there is a what we call flying cell tower. I was the lead in demonstrating the very first flying cell tower in the US that was done in May 2017. There is a publication in IEEE Spectrum, September 2018 issue has published that. So that's my background. So let's get into the real project. So the project is about vehicle-to-vehicle communication. So what do we mean by vehicle-to-vehicle communication? Take a look at picture. The picture simply shows, well, there is a, and this is my, just I drew about a few days back. This is a ground control station. Now, in a big world, in a commercial world, this is like air traffic control. But in case of drones, this is going to be like a simple system. You know, it doesn't have to be big building. You know, you don't have to have high towers. It's basically a simple system where you host the computers to share information with the drones. So think of this like a simple system. For example, in the project, it's simply a laptop or a computer with basic communication equipment. So you don't have to think about this big. Then I placed two drones just to showcase that there are two drones up in the air. And you have a communication channel from the ground to one of the drones, and the one drone is communicating to other drone. So this is a very general framework of what we mean by vehicle-to-vehicle communication. Very specifically, V2V means you are trying to establish a communication channel between two vehicles, a pair of vehicles rather, using whatever means. We'll talk about the technologies later, but just say our goal is to establish communication channel between two drones. And then of course, it cannot exist on its own. When we talk about V2V, it cannot exist on its own. You have to have a ground communication too. So basically, drone one is communicating to ground control station. Again, don't think ground control station is too big. It's just your laptop, for example. In the project, you'll have your laptop is the ground control station. Of course, it requires some means of communicating. Okay, and then this drone one is also talking to drone two. By the way, I'm using the words drone, unmanned aerial vehicle, unmanned aircraft system in this on the same lines. So basically, all are same. All three are same at this point. So this is what I meant by V2V. Then why is this important? So let's say, I'll give you here is the reason why we want to V2V communication. V2V communication is required for traffic management, tracking, coordination, positioning, and beyond visual line of sight communication, beyond radio line of sight communication, routing and others. So these are the primary reasons why we need V2V communication. Obviously, V2V communication can be established in at least primarily in three different ways. You can use satellite communication, We can use cellular like 4G and 5G, LTE, for example, or you can have a direct communication. So when I say direct communication, think of like Wi-Fi or vehicle-to-vehicle communication that we have today for drones, like DSRC. DSRC is dedicated short-range communication. Today, DSRC makes use of V2V communications for automobiles. And even though you don't see a lot, but in research and development communities, DSRC is widely used. It follows, of course, IEEE V2V standard for automobiles. So primarily, there are three means of vehicle-to-vehicle communication. One is satellite, second like our SATCOM, second is cellular, like 4G and 5G or LTE. The third is the kind of direct communication I'm referring to that we are interested in. So out of all three, there was a question about latency. I'm going to come. So the three things, you know, you can, in general, you know, is a broad comparison, very broad comparison. Satellite is unlimited coverage. And obviously, satellite communication is available everywhere, right? That you can understand, unlimited coverage. But it takes a lot of time. Think about the communication, the round trip. Of course, the signals are going to travel at the speed of light, but still, because of computation related activities and hardware and software, all those latencies will add up. And then the latency here means what is the time it takes for a round trip communication from the vehicle to the ground through satellite. Okay, so now you can understand that because the communication has to go through a satellite, which is very high, far away from the ground, then it takes obviously more time. That is what I meant by latency. Latency is the time, how much time it takes from the communication to take place. Now, for example, let's say you want to send a control command, navigation control and command to a drone using SATCOM. It takes some time. It is not negligible. However, there are a lot of development that are going on. For example, Iridium and low Earth orbit satellites. So with that, with those new satellite technologies, the latency is coming down. Okay? It is not really that bad. But of course, you know, remember that commercial aviation makes use of satellite all the time. So it is a standard technology, and we can still depend on it. But in comparison to other means of communication, like cellular and direct communication, obviously the latency is largest. And with the cellular, we can, in broad terms, it's medium coverage. It depends on what is the range of cell tower communication. And so in comparison to satellite communication, cellular communications have sort of less latency, or in comparison among the three, I would say it is medium latency. Just to give a number, think about it's about in hundreds of milliseconds. Okay, that is what, even though we say latency, not even a second. It's about 1/10 of a second. That's what we're talking about. In all the three. But even in that milliseconds, if you compare, the three are different in this way. Coverage is the best for satellite. Of course, for a direct communication like Wi-Fi, the coverage is the least. It takes very small coverage. In terms of latency or time, satellite communication takes largest latency, whereas for a direct communications, the lowest latency. So this is a very general categorization, okay? Then of course, you have to go into details. So these are the three modes of communication. Now, if you want to establish a direct communication, what are the challenges? Please remember that even in 3GPP and LTE, we have what we call device-to-device communication. It's also is very close to what we are talking about. Of course, device-to-device communication in 3GPP is kind of more tested and available for devices on the ground. However, for drones, testing efforts are going on, but not fully tested. You know, we need to still develop technology in 3GPP to make sure that it can be applied to drones. That work is still in premature or early stages. So suppose say this is for this slide is for people who are doing research in 5G, 4G, or cellular communications. Imagine that you're trying to establish a direct link, just like the way the picture. You want to establish a link between two drones. So what are the challenges? Challenges are, first of all, it seems like it's a good idea to, because you're going up in the air, there are no obstacles, so you have a direct line of sight. Okay? But when you get into details, when you try to work or implement, you will see a lot of challenges. For example, one question is, where do you put the antenna? There it's like you have a 360 degrees, like a sphere now. Where do you place? The big challenge is, it doesn't matter wherever you place, you still cannot get a clear line of sight component, line of sight, a clear path between the two vehicles all the time. It's not possible. For example, imagine that the drone actually is making a turn. Then what is interesting here is, even the aircraft body itself will obstruct the line of sight. It's a really a huge challenge, and people are still figuring out, where do I put the antenna? One option is, let's put more antenna. Maybe ideally all over the plane, so that it doesn't matter how you turn, go up and down, you know, left turn, right turn, still you have some sort of a antenna, at least one antenna communicating with the other. But there is no limit, right? How many antennas you want to keep? And it adds to payload, it adds to communication cost, station cost. So it's not so easy to say, let's put all over. But of course, that is one way to look at. Then, we say, it is this is again for those people who are doing research and academic research. So yeah, multi-path fading is very less. That means you have a clear line of sight. If you can establish a clear line of sight, then you don't have any obstacles in the air. So given that, your signal is going to be almost perfect, but that is an ideal condition. One more big challenge that we haven't really understood or we need to work on is called the Doppler effect. You know, we talked about, everybody knows Doppler effect. However, we were able to address in terrestrial communications very easily because not much. Doppler shift is not much. When two vehicles are moving in 100 miles an hour, for example, then like search and rescue operation, you are flying drones up in the air, and you are flying, the drones can fly 50 miles per hour, at least 50, 100, maybe 200, depending on context situation. But given that the speeds are very high, the Doppler frequency shift is significant. To just give an idea, it can go up to maybe hundreds of kilohertz, like 200 to in the range of 200 kilohertz. So we need to look at that carefully. We cannot just neglect. So the biggest, this is a reference from published researcher in Singapore, Roy Zhang. According to the latest article published, dominance of line of sight links may suggest the emerging MM wave communication could be employed to achieve high capacity UAV to UAV wireless backhaul. On the other hand, high relative velocity between vehicles coupled with high frequency and could lead to excessive Doppler shift. So we need to study. This is a research question, research problem for people who are working. So now let's coming to, what are we trying to do in 1920.1 is more of an aerial network. We started with the big picture. We talked about like ad hoc aerial network. Then we realized while we are developing the standard, I think we need to focus more on one link first, just one link, vehicle to vehicle. Understand the issues and challenges. So that's how we began, we got into 1920.2. So there are a bunch of other related standards. For example, I was referring to vehicle-to-vehicle communications for automobiles, and that is IEEE 1609. That's also called WAVE. So it was developed by IEEE Vehicular Technology Society. The same group, the same society, IEEE VTS, where you're all members, and we are now working on the new standard 1920.2. So VTS is a society, VTS is an organization that is championing the drone-to-drone communication. I would like you to just appreciate that. Then there is one very closely related standard called remote ID. This is again very, very important standard that just recently was released. Of course, in still discussion, but it is, you have the standard out in the public. FAA, Federal Aviation Administration in the US, is looking into this, or it is evaluating. That is called, that is by ASTM. ASTM internationally, initially in old days, it used to be American Society for Testing Materials, but now it's an international standards organization. It developed this ID, the standards for remote ID and tracking. Remember, if you want to develop vehicle to vehicle communication, then the first thing is you need identification. So notice the relation between remote ID and vehicle to vehicle communication. You need to identify your aircraft first. There should be a unique ID, just like our VIN number for vehicles, automobiles. At the same time, for communication point of view, you need to have an address. So how do you come up with a MAC address, something equivalent to MAC address? So those are the important things before we think about V2V. So ASTM, that I was referring to, the US remote ID and tracking standards developed by ASTM, is very, very important. In terms of this communication, you know, you need to think about how do we address, how do we come up with the address, something like our OSI layer kind of networking protocol. If you want to develop a protocol for vehicle to vehicle communications, we need to think about how do we come up with addressing, unique addressing scheme. How do we discover the neighbors? How do we form the network? How do we create a link, even one communication link? And then if you obviously, one link can be, if you expand one link, you can create a whole network. So you need to think about routing and all that. There are a bunch of literature you can see in the community or in journals and magazines. But remember, this is not tested yet. I mean, testing a vehicle-to-vehicle communication is a very huge task. We can do a lot of simulations, but practically, will it work? That requires a lot of experimentation. So that is where we are today. So even though you see almost like thousands and thousands of papers on these topics, but practically, does it work? That needs to be verified. That needs to be tested experimentally. So one more important thing before we get into competition issues is that even a channel, how do you model a channel between drone to drone? That is a very, very relevant topic of current research. Those who are graduate students today working on their PhDs and master's thesis, that is one topic of interest to the community. There are, again, you'll see a lot of publications, but they're still theoretical, just simulations. Practically, what are a good channel model for vehicle to vehicle? Still a research topic, open research topic. I think I've given the background. Now let's look into specifics. Okay. What do we mean by V2V? We need to have. We can think of a protocol. Someone can come up with a protocol, or you can address any one of these topics. Like, how do we come up with a unique address? How do we discover neighbors? Maybe what kind of format? What kind of format we need between vehicle-to-vehicle communication? How do we share the? Can we come up with a data format at least satisfies or meets the requirement of some applications? And the biggest challenge is, you know, some people already mentioned in the questions, is that okay? How do you create a link? Because you lose the connection quite often, so that is a problem. Now the next question is, what is that we want to do? Okay, let me now bring up the questions. So here are the questions that I've seen from the list. It is about 30 minutes into the presentation. So now we are beginning a specific project. So the questions are, you know, what kind of policies and procedures? We are still working on that. I will work with Dr. Puneet Mishra and then the IEEE team Bangalore. We'll figure out, okay, how do we make this happen? Suppose you come up with a project, you come up with a great solution, how do we demonstrate it? So we're still working on it. We don't have a means. For example, ideally, we should have a place where we let the drones fly. For example, let's say you come up with, you bring your drone with the hardware and software, then we should be able to fly it in some open environment. But will it be possible? There are a bunch of issues like safety, primarily safety issues. So given that, for now, let's assume that you will bring some hardware and software with or without drone. And just for example, you can just bring a Raspberry Pi with your program. Maybe two Raspberry Pis with program. And then will you go and come and demonstrate without the need of an actual drone. So it's possible to go to that level. For example, if safety is a big concern, especially in to fly a drone during the conference, then we can think of just, you know, you bring your Raspberry Pi with your software, maybe two of them, and showcase how it works. Maybe you come up with a protocol, or maybe you come up with a way to address this connection challenge.
So, Dr. Kamesh, sorry to interrupt you. Yeah, Puneet here. So there is a big chunk of land is available at the conference venue, so we should be able to fly. So that should not be a problem.
Wonderful. Yeah, that is thank you, Dr. Puneet. Yeah, great. So once we settle down this, then we will be able to most likely fly your Raspberry Pi or whatever controller you bring and put it on the drone that we may have at the facility, or you can bring your own drone. But again, keep in mind there will be some challenges, like in terms of safety and security point of view. Also, given the corona virus issue, there may be other obstacles that we may be facing. So we are ignoring all those things and we are going ahead with the plan. But being adaptable and flexible. Challenges. So then the next is hardware and software. What hardware and software we want to use? Again, this is completely open, but some suggestions could be you can use a basic controller that has Wi-Fi, for example. Assume that you are using Wi-Fi. You want to use 802.11 kind of Wi-Fi communication. So all you need is some controller like Raspberry Pi or Android some other controller like NVIDIA that has some computational capability as well as the communication capability like Wi-Fi. Or you can also use LTE dongle, for example. We have used in our previous experiments, we put a LTE device access point on the drone, and then that we could use for communication too. So one thing is, obviously, a drone will have its own autopilot. So we should not interfere with the autopilot. Make sure that you are not interfering with the autopilot, because that would create some issues. You don't really interfere with drone communications, like the main communication channel, like for example, RC controller. So you don't disturb that channel. Plus, you don't really disturb the autopilot. So without that, you come up with your own hardware and software. For example, Raspberry Pi or Arduino or NVIDIA Jetson. So whatever hardware you use, obviously it has to be small. If it is more than 1 lb, maybe the drone may not be even able to lift off, able to carry it. It has to be smallest. And as far as the battery is concerned, the power, there are two options. You can add your own battery to the Raspberry Pi or whatever microcontroller you have, or you can tap onto drone's battery. If you want to tap onto drone's battery, the plus point is, yeah, you don't have to add more battery, which means the payload will be small. On the other hand, if you want to integrate with the drone's battery, then you have to make sure that you have the right wiring and all that. So that is, again, your group has to take care of. Of course, once you come to the conference, probably there will be some help with the organizers that can provide, but you have to come up with a way to tap from the get the battery power from the drone's battery if you want to do that. But that has to be, you need to take time, you need to give enough time when you come to the conference to demonstrate, to make sure that you can do that. The safe solution is bring your own battery, but make sure the total payload is not more than 1 pound. If it is more than 1 pound, you may get into some issues. And then you can bring your own drone if you are very comfortable and if you can do it. Even one is enough. For example, even though we are talking about two drones up in the air and one in the ground, ideally you need three communication pieces, one from here to here and one from here to here. So basically, the communication equipment will be here on one drone, it's on the second drone as well, and one unit will be on the ground. That is how I did when I was doing this project. But in your case, I think if you bring with one equipment, one on the ground and one in the air, that is good enough. For example, you are really looking at, even though we say V2V, but you are actually looking at, you're going to demonstrate ground versus from ground communication to ground to air. So you are looking at, you can demonstrate just one link. Okay? So that is good enough for the competition, for the challenge. But ideally in the real world, you need three units, one unit over here, one communication unit over here, and one on the ground. But again, for the competition point of view, you can think of just one this link, or you can think of, like, you know, as if this is on the ground, this drone is on the ground. You don't need a drone. When you keep on the ground, you don't even need a drone. The second one, at least one drone is definitely required. So you can come up with everything that you need to demonstrate hardware and software with one drone, and the second piece of equipment could be on the ground. I hope that is made clear. Level of project. I think we are looking for a very basic level, which means that just showcase some simple idea. Simplicity is the key. Okay? So for example, just show, keep one Raspberry Pi on the ground and one Raspberry Pi with the drone, and maybe on a building. You can just keep on the building. Even simpler scenario is, you just carry one drone all around the area. One drone will be on the ground. One Raspberry Pi will be on the ground. So think of in whatever you brainstorm among your group members, team members, and come up with a simple plan. And if you have any, of course, while you are starting the project, preparing for the project, if you have questions during the design stage, reach out to us. Reach out to Dr. Puneet Mishra and the team, BTS and Bangalore, and I will also be happy to answer any questions. What kind of communication you want to use? You can use any communication. Use Wi-Fi, Bluetooth, maybe too small a range. Then LoRa is a good idea. Somebody brought up LoRa, and I have used LoRa. If you can program or configure it well, it has a reasonable range. It can go up to kilometers. One thing you to remember is, as you go up in the air, your line of sight will be very good, and then you get a stronger signal. The communication range will be almost like sometimes 10 times higher than on the ground. So it's great to see that you have a better line of sight and less path loss in the air. But what is interesting is, if you're only playing with a couple of drones, you can see this wonderful advantage. But the moment you see more and more number of drones, the problem becomes the same thing that we thought is good. The strong signal is going to fail. Can you hear me? Looks like people are saying they cannot hear.
We can hear you.
Okay, wonderful. So remember, the point here is, what I'm trying to make is that Yeah, if you have only a couple of drones, then the line of sight is, I mean, you can see a very good signal strength, strong signal. But the same thing will work against us if you have more number of drones. People have shown that, people have seen that if you put hundreds of drones, then the same strong signal will be interference with the others. So that's a very interesting thing that we come up, that came up in some experiments. So keep that in mind. Okay? But of course, when you're flying only a couple of drones, yeah, you get a good signal. That's wonderful. So what is the communication range? For this, I think let's not worry about coming up with a big range. Of course, we can show longer range, that's always better. But for the demonstration point of view, for example, Wi-Fi, if you don't use any directional antennas and all that, obviously the communication range is going to be not more than, maybe if you can even bring 100 feet, that is great. So depending on your technology, if you use Wi-Fi, maybe your range is limited, especially when you're testing in the campus. LoRa may be a little more, because then, as your name stands, long range communication, so we expect it to have longer range than Wi-Fi. And of course, if you have better solutions like directional antennas and all that, even though they are not really required for this competition or this challenge, but you are welcome to try directional antennas. Directional antennas will be better, longer range. And then what about LTE? You can use a LTE access point or what you call dongle kind of a USB kind of device that you can plug in. You can use LTE too. If you have 5G equipment, wonderful, that's great too. So there is no restriction in terms of what you can use. It's up to you and up to you what facilities you have, what infrastructure you have. Protocol development. In fact, really speaking, 1920.2 is really developing this protocol. Now we are trying to look at different use cases and see what kind of format, what kind of data format protocol that we can develop. So anything that you can do, for example, you can come up with a simple protocol development and then try to demonstrate. That's great. And the remaining, these questions are a little more advanced, like relevance to AI, Internet of Things, computer vision. But if you are working in computer vision, for example, you want to come up with a solution based on computer vision, like for example, using drone-to-drone communication, if you can assist a drone to land safely on the ground, and maybe that requires some camera to look around the area and see, is it safe to land in this area? By the way, NASA has developed a small technology called safe to ditch. What it does is, it's a unit that is on the drone. It will look on the ground and make sure that it is safe to land. It's not landing on people or buildings or some ditch. So you can use computer vision. Come up with a simple idea. Again, the focus is, can you demonstrate the simplest idea that you can think of? So simplicity is the key. But it should be, it should have lot of value, simple solution, but lot of significant in terms of what it can provide to drone communication. Your application could be anything. You can think of, you can imagine, maybe you're taking the railway tracks. Are they safe? Safety of railway tracks. And by the way, it's a great application. People are using drones for monitoring or surveying the tracks. And then agriculture. Obviously, the huge application given in countries like India and in many US also, agriculture is, especially in India, agriculture is the main activity for many people. So anything that you can do to help farmers or to help yielding, increase the yield of the crop, like checking for any problems in the crop, that will be great. And, okay. So it's completely open. You can think of, you can use your own hardware and software as long as it has small footprint. And then project need to be simple, easy to understand. And you can contribute to protocols. You can contribute to increasing the range, for example, if you have a solution to increase the range, that is good. And I won't talk too much on AI because it's up to you in terms of how you can use machine intelligence or artificial intelligence to come up with your problem. You can, in terms of IoT, basically, you can use any other sensors. You can also combine with a bunch of, like, for example, camera is also a sensor. So you can use any other sensors to add value to the problem, the solution. Whether it is camera-based solution, and the applications could be anything, you know, how you can make something better. In fact, you know, when you look at IEEE slogan, it is for helping the humans, like humanitarian technologies is the key. So anything that you can come up with that has value to making our lives better in any domain, railways, agriculture, any industry, the solution could use any kind of sensors, any IoT kind of sensors, or any maybe some machine learning program, computer vision, all these things are up to you. You define your problem. What we are looking for is, can you demonstrate, can you build your solution or based around vehicle-to-vehicle communication? So that is the... So that is what we want to see. Okay, so the problem is completely open. It should be based on vehicle-to-vehicle communication. It should have good value towards application. Okay. So the one somebody just asked, is application important? And I think application is important, right? You need to think about why are we doing this? What is the value that is going to be? You don't need to demonstrate the application. You don't need to worry about demonstrating the application. You should have the application should drive your research, drive your project. I think we already about 48 minutes into the presentation, so I will stop here and ask Puneet Mishra to say a few words, and then we'll open up.
Yeah, thank you, Dr. Kamesh, for nicely summing up all the questions as well as discussing about UAV to UAV communication and the work which you have already carried out and you are still carrying out. And we are having more than 50 participants. I think there was a 400 registration and we stopped, but because of lockdown and corona threat, people are not able to manage connections. That may be the reason. However, we will go ahead with this, and I would request that a few people have written some questions on the chat box. If you can go through that, you will be able to answer those questions as well as,
okay,
because we are seeing some two or three questions only, so we will answer that and we will close the webinar.
That's a good idea. I just started looking at the chat. Let me go through one by one.
Okay? Yeah.
We already answered the first question about latency. So once again, it's the latency is the time it takes for one-way or two-way communication. For example, from drone to the ground control, from drone to drone, really. Whatever way you can implement, latency is a time delay, rather. Showcasing the use case is necessary. You know, the question is, do we need to show the use case? The use case, you keep that in the bigger context. You don't need to demonstrate the use case, but use case should be included in your project. And then the demonstration could be just on the protocol. Maybe it could be a protocol, it could be a communication, a B2B communication aspect. Doesn't have to be the entire communication too. Let's, for example, in a simplest scenario, when we did the real flight test last summer, we just shared the GPS coordinates. We have two drones, and actually we have three units. One unit was placed on the ground. Let me call that as a V2V system. You know, like it could be controller, microcontroller, and the communication means. Like we use DSRC. So there is a radio. We use three radios. One radio was on the ground. One and the two other radios are with the two drones. So each of these drones were just simply transmitting their location information. So all we did is the packet, we just put the GPS coordinates. So on the ground, we are able to collect, continuously track where these vehicles are. So for the demonstration point of view, it's sufficient if you demonstrate the communication aspect, but it's always good to have the use case in the back of your mind while you are building the product. Next question is how to optimize power when deploying new communication protocol, and also wanted to how to optimize the performance of the edge devices. So the thing is, really speaking, communication is costlier. Obviously, communication is costlier compared to, it takes power, it takes more energy compared to computation. So it is a big deal, because every time if you want to communicate, let's say for example, every second, maybe even more, let's say for example, you are sending 100 packets per second, which means that you are spending communication power, you are using energy. So given that the question about optimization is, what is the frequency of the communication? How fast, how frequently you need to communicate your data? So that's again a good problem. And that you need to think about, depending on the application, the frequency can be varied. Like for example, obviously computer vision is a pretty intensive application. So given that, you want to balance the communication and computation, the energy that you're spending between computation and communication. I think it depends primarily on the application, what application you're working on. But given the speed at which drones fly, so your frequency depends on how fast your vehicle is moving. Suppose you are doing you're just hovering there, then you don't need to spend much information. But if you are moving fast, then I think the location, sharing the location becomes important. Keep this, it is more like a research problem, but we will talk more on this down the line. While you're doing the project, you can still reach out to us by email. In terms of autopilot is obviously necessary, right? Again, I suggest that we keep the application sort of independent of the autopilot, because autopilot should be undisturbed. Of course, if you are very good in programming, then you can manage. But the suggestion here is don't interfere with the autopilot. Keep the drone, its autopilot, different. So for example, there is a remote control channel for remote control, right? Or autopilot also has its own channel. So we are not really interfering with that channel. So think of V2V as a separate channel, it's more like a data channel, not the control channel. So that's what I have. I think I answered all the questions.
So thank you, Dr. Kamesh. Thank you very much for waking up so early at your place and conducting this webinar. Before closing this webinar, I request all the participants to participate in this challenge, which IEEE VTS, because of the help from Dr. Kamesh, we are able to fund it. Top six teams, depending upon your proposal, how nicely you have written your proposal, what kind of technologies you are going to use and demonstrate during Connect. We will be selecting six teams and we will be funding them with $500 so that you can use that money for procurement of various accessories and components. In addition to that, we will be selecting 10 students also who can be using some AI and ML related work using microcontrollers. So please submit and register for that challenge. And hopefully this webinar has given you all the information which you needed to proceed further. Because of Corona effect, we have extended the deadline also to April 15th. Even though you are not in your college, you can always use electronic media to communicate with your friends and mentors and guides to submit the proposal. It is better that you submit the proposal by April 15th, and we will evaluate them with the help of Dr. Kamesh, and we will be informing you hopefully within next 7 to 10 days after last date of submission. Thank you very much.
Please follow up. If you have any further questions, reach out by through email.
Yes.
Thank you, Dr. Punit Mishra. Thanks for organizing this.
Thank you.
Thank you very much. We will be closing this webinar now.